mehr, glaube ich.
Okay. Thank you very much for introduction. As you heard, I have been at the university since 4 years, and before that time, 25 years at SGL. So my presentation takes up a little bit the view of the industry and how it goes on with the carbon composites in the future. First of all, I think some have seen this picture similar before. It's the newest one from this year. What you can recognize is that we have a constant annual growth of 10 to 12%, and this is guided by the automotive and by the aerospace. Totally, that means we have a revenue of $126 billion, controlled mostly by the aviation, aerospace and defense industry, and by the automotive, as I said before. Then we have the wind energy, the sporting goods, and what you also heard today, the construction is coming now. And another field which is very important in future, I think, that's the marine application of CFP, because of the high strength, with a high density of water and the aggressive area. Okay, if you look more in detail, what does it mean? You can see that most of the material or revenue is done by this segment. You have the automotive part and the others. The middle price of the composites are around $80 to $90, and in aerospace you can get a higher value. Looking for the polymers which are needed, we have amount of $19.3 billion polymers. The market, most of the matrix systems are polymers, about 68%. And from these polymers, 70% are thermosets. So the thermoplastics not yet are in that range as thermosets. What does that mean, or what is the consequence? We have a process chain where we have to take in account that the material is directly produced during the process itself. That's a point. It is an additive manufacturing. Keep this in mind. This additive manufacturing means you have to combine in a key process a polymer with a textile. And that's the most time-consuming and cost-contribution fact. The processes you know for to combine both are today the pull-to-prepeg process, the pultrusion and winding process, and the wet lamination. These three are the most important ones. And 91 kilotons of this material are produced in with this types here. Coming back to how many carbon fibers we have to produce with these technologies, we have an overview up to now. We have a capacity at the manufacturers of about 136 kilotons. So Toray is go together with Soltec, so they are the largest at the moment. SGL, where I have been for 25 years, is the second supplier, and the others are all building up more or less additional capacity. That's the situation. Distributed on the market or on the areas, you see that the regions, the most region is the USA and Mexico. Then we are here in Germany, the Germans, and the other are the Japans. And China is coming also with amounts of capacities. That's the actual situation. So we have 136,000 tons of carbon fibers available on the market. Looking to other construction materials, you see the concrete, and we have discussed before about the situation of the concrete, what it means, the steel. That is not, I think, a good idea to use such an energy efficient material. We can see the plastics, and we see aluminium, there here we have a carbon fiber, so it's a niche market up to now. And that we have to recognize, that's the situation. Looking to the plastics, we see we have 299 million tons of plastic material. In Europe, there are 57. This material mostly is the polyolefin or polypropylene material. So a material you normally don't use for reinforcement of carbon fibers. The only possibility perhaps Samsonite will need some tons. Who knows? Maybe that not becomes too expensive, they will do it. Okay, but that, what does that mean it? As a consequence, the global need for polymers in CFRP is only 50,000 tons. And that's the point why the chemical industry is not very busy in inventing new polymers we need. Coming back to history, in 1975, the BASF had the impression that the high-performance polymers will increase within the next 15 years or 25 years up to 30%. But the reality was totally different. 15 years later, it was the same as before. So the low-cost polymers, the not high-performance polymers, are still those polymers we have today. And if you want to increase something here, you need about 9,000 tons per year, so the chemical industry says, when it is cost efficient for them. If it's lower, they don't do it. Coming back to the situation that the process optimized polymers may be useful because they can influence the 75% of the costs you have for the CFRP, then it doesn't matter if a polymer, which only have a cost contribution of 5%, will cost 15%. That doesn't matter, but it can reduce the polymer process, the infiltration process. And that might be the chance to go down with the price, the kilo price, in the area where we are with aluminium. So that's the point we have to recognize. So what are the cost-driving things at the infiltration? We have to go into the textile, the carbon textile with a monomer, that might be a Duroset or a thermoplastic, or with a finished polymerized thermoplastic which has been polymerized. Both processes are difficult because you have mostly have a high viscosity, so it means the polymers are not adjusted to the process. They are the polymers which are investigated and invented in a time where nobody knows something about the processes of carbon fibers. So what can we do? When we look for a key process and we think what might be help us, we first have the situation we have to prepare the textile which we want to infiltrate in the next step. So we have to prepare the monomer for infiltration. We can also powder, it's another possibility. Then we have to consolidate it. We have to perform a reaction, a polymerization reaction. And all is combined with heating. When finished the part, you have to cool it down and then some finishing operations. So you can add the process as a time scale in each of these time contributions to have to recognize when you develop a process-adapted polymer. What are the process-relevant topics? First of all, I said viscosity, that's clear. A high viscosity is not easy for infiltration. Then you have the reaction time of the polymerization, which can be initiated by temperature or by radiation, that doesn't matter. You have the degree of current you have to think about, you have byproducts you handle, the reaction can be exothermal, you can have shrinkage, you can have shrinkages. These are the process relevant topics you have to take into account when developing a new polymer. Then you have application relevant topics. So first of all the plus transition temperature or the maximum temperature usage, then something like the allocation and break of the polymer, that's important. Tenacity, notched impact strength, all the other things like flame resistant we heard today, the resistant against defined media and resistant against load cycles is also important. And with this material, you have to go to the market, so you have to think about the price and about the capacity, which is correlated to the situation for the customers. The customers are the target industries in general, the most important ones you know, we have spoken about it. So we have some others, we have building and construction, which is coming, with civil engineering, then marine, it's a little bit far, but it will also come. So all these are industries which can use carbon fibers in the future. Also agriculture, if you look how much, how heavy the machines are, which are working on our ground, so you also can think about weight. So the focus on the market is absolutely necessary. You have to know what you must do that the market is heavy. Now we have a situation that the EU Commission has given the chance for new calls. So there was a brokerage event in Brussels, especially the open innovation bets, I would say. And all what I have said now, I use to think how we can contribute to the calls which are now actually existent. One of them is the open innovation test bed for lightweight, nano-enabled, multifunctional composite material components. So this is a call where we can contribute with those process-adapted polymers, which might be a key for a breakthrough. Why? We can adapt innovative aspects with the process. We can use a nanostructural approach. That means we can influence the crystallinity at the surface of a carbon fiber in connection with the polymer structure itself. So we can influence with a carbon fiber the polymer crystallinity. That's one approach. Another approach is we can make something around the carbon fiber which also influence the interface and the correlation with the polymer. That's also new. And another thing, we have new polymers which are available but not yet on the market, and they can be adapted to the special situation of a carbon fiber. So we have chemical and physical cross-linking, which is rubber seal. That's interesting for recycling aspects. What can we do with such polymers? What do we think? We can reduce the weight more than 40%. We can reduce the costs from 75%, which is influenced by the polymers, to 25%. We can go down with the price to the area of aluminium. We have the potential for further material because we learn a lot when we are doing this. And last not least, these new polymer systems allow a lot of new aspects in combination with additive manufacturing. What are the polymers? I told a little bit before. They are thermoplastic. They are polymers with a thermoplastic behavior before the final curing step. That's a possibility. They are polymers with a reversible network formation. They have a controlled moldability and a complete dissolution possibility, so you can do recycling. And you have some possibilities to make some stimuli responsive behavior so that you have an intelligent behavior of a structure itself. And the shape memory behavior of such polymers is also a point. So that are the process adapted polymers. Then we have the second call, which might be usable. The second call is in the spire area. here it is mentioned that energy and resource flexibility in highly energy intensive industry will be funded. What does that mean? As I told before, the chemical industry has no interest to produce this polymer when you only need some tons per year, probably. So we may say, okay, 9,000 tons, that's the minimum. If you use less, we will do nothing. So why not producing the polymer directly at the process? That's possible. You can use microflow reactor approach, so not a batch reactor, but a microflow reactor. So you have a streaming tube, and so you can combine your components so that last but least you have your polymer exactly at that moment when you have to infiltrate. So you don't need the chemical industry, you only have to buy the monomers from the industry. That might be the second approach for the innovative breakthrough for the material. Coming back to the partners, we are looking for partners for both calls. Still open for discussion, we could contribute something. What we have in Germany is the Carbon Composite e.V., who started the leading edge cluster, MyCarbon, which is now working for 5 years, funded by 40 million euro by the national government. And they are installed in the Augsburg area, and they can do everything in combination with what I have said before. So we have the chance to make basic research. So we have institutes, we are trained now in the correlation between polymer and fiber. We have the DLR and Fraunhofer, which make process technology. We have applied research, we have a technology center where startups can go in and look for possibilities. And we have the innovation park, which allows to extend the research. Now we have finished the leading edge cluster and start with the second funded project, that's the Campus Carbon 4.0. It is funded by Bavaria. It is starting now. It has started now at the beginning of the year. And it is realizing concepts which are based on the leading edge cluster. So we generates the knowledge along the process chain, carbon fiber and reinforced polymers together with the industry. The structures of the leading edge clusters are used. We have a polymer center. We have an engineering center. We produce the materials, inclusive the machining, and we have the recycling topic. So, a whole concept. We have a total process and life cycle in view. We look for the raw materials, we look for the residues, and last but not least, we have a total process chain under control. So that's the aspect. What does it mean in detail? For example, you can see it in the next slide. This is a production of a carbon fiber structure which doesn't use any bolt. This is developed by the architect of Stuttgart. So they make a roof module combined with glass fibers and carbon fibers. But that means you can do anything like that also with other parts. So no bolt, and you only have to impregnate the fiber before you are winding it. Impregnating, for example, with such a microflow reactor approach. So no chemistry problem. Chemistry industry to produce your polymer exactly at the moment where you need it. And now I show you a last slide. These are examples of such structures which are produced with a similar technology. You only have the fibers where you need it, and especially, I think this part, it's in the Airbus. It lasts about, I think, 15 tons. You can load it for a internal part of a aeroplane. So that's a possibility. And coming back to questions, if you have one.
You are ready for a project by yourself.
Okay.
If Germany has, you know, in Germany you have a lot of these activities, even also test beds, and so on. The problem is how you share this with other European countries for a European project, because that's very good in a national level.
Yeah.
European projects is more complicated, but if you are so complete in the sense of having all the infrastructures around.
Yes, we have a possibility also to fund it with national money.
Yes,
but
it's
the
very
money
good.
Is, but the money is not enough to make a breakthrough, so we additionally need the European concept.
Yeah.
And we also can define different topics so that we have no overlapping. And it would be good or fine, perhaps, from this.
Yeah,
to
here to
have some partners,
like that,
But it's a little bit complicated because we need hardcore chemists.
Mm.
That's not easy to find in Europe. That might be the problem. So we are now, I have represented it at different brokerage events, at the brokerage event of the EU Commission and at the Syscan event, and I now get feedback. But the feedback at first is, I will contribute. When I ask, what's your contribution? Then they, they don't know, really know what they can do. And that's actually the situation. Okay.
Yeah, one more question.
We were involved with Birmingham University on a clean unwinding project, and that's used, and also. I'm just wondering how you're wetting out the pipes comes to use. There was a big focus on a project for that.
No, I didn't get it, sorry. Acoustic is not very good in this room.
We were involved with Birmingham University on a clean filament winding project.
Okay.
So the idea is just that you're reducing the reacting resin.
Okay.
Point of use, very much like you're using.
That's
there.
Fine. So you're a partner, no?
Yeah, I'm just
a possible partner. Yeah.
Yeah. No, it's just that clearly that's what you're doing. It seems that there's a parallel approach.
Yes.
But also, and I'm speaking now for the university, not for myself. The university has done a lot of work on fibre spreading to get very efficient wetting.
Yes.
I don't know whether you are using that. As
we are also spreading.
Okay, so it's probably parallel.
That the spreading is a topic we know how to do it.
Okay.
No, not a problem for us.
Yes. Is it useful for you to talk with Birmingham on that?
Anyway, yes.
As I say, it's only what I see.
So if you give me a contact or give my contact to them,
sure.
Well,
yeah,
very good.
Appreciate it. Thanks.